introduce you to our second keynote today. So it is my pleasure to have Francisca Hain as our keynote speaker. So she studied media design in Brown's University of Cayman. Sorry if I pronounced the name of the university wrong. Her thesis was on software for analyzing video recording. She is a head of software development at Media Deutschland. She's responsible for 40 people, ranging from community communication specialists over product management and design software engineering. Wikidata is the biggest project being developed by her team. She's going to speak about that on the topic. And without delay, it is my pleasure to have you here.
Chapters and affiliates, but like a rather big organization also, are coming together, and you can see a picture there of the beautiful crowd cheering, being happy. That was before the summit. And all those people come together from all over the world to talk about things that matter to us and about our role in society, because similar to your organization, we play a big role in one way or the other. And we care about making the project that has been started maybe 20 years ago into something that's going to be relevant also in the years to come, and to figure out what that means. And it was very intense 3 days, and it was once more reassurance of our connectedness on one hand side to the world, but also to the people and the cultures and to technical and social systems, because that's what's happening there. All those things are coming together when you have people from all over the world together. There were already a couple of show of hands questions today. I'm also going to do a couple of them. So who of you uses Wikipedia on a regular basis? Who's editing it? Similar effect like with the questions before. And now the actual question is, who of you knows about Wikidata? And I don't even dare to ask, but who does something with it? I saw the open refine on your slide, so I'm okay, wonderful. So what I would like you to understand is that the Wikimedia movement consists of many different projects. Of course, the Wikipedias are big ones everybody knows about, but we call them sister projects, and there are really many of them. There is the other big one, which is Wikimedia Commons, where you can find all images and videos, and it's really amazing and awesome, and it's going to be even more amazing and awesome really soon. And we have small things like Wiki Voyage, where people are writing travel reviews, and where you can go when you go somewhere and you can get a suggestion for what to do and how to do it. And what I want to talk with you about today is, what is Wikidata actually? Some of you know a couple of things already, but to start with the very basic, this is what Wikidata is, for example. It's what answers questions you might have to Alexa or Siri. They are actually using the data that has been produced there. Wikidata is this, the results Google serves you when you're trying to find information about the world. And you this, a map of the world. And this map is created by millions of little dots. And each of those dots represents an item with a geo-coordinate. And I tell you, we have more items in the database that do not have geo-coordinates, not all of them. And what you see there is a progression over 3 years. And I think it provides a pretty impressive view on the journey that's behind us. Because Wikidata was started nearly 7 years ago by people working at Wikimedia Germany. And I have to say, I only joined 1.5 years ago, so not to my credit. And the idea they had was quite simple. It was about making inter-wiki links semantic. So when you have, for example, a link to Birmingham, in the article about the United Kingdom, you could give it a title. For example, located in. So the computers could understand the type of relationship. And today, after 7 years, Wikidata contains more than 58 million items. We have more than 5,500 properties, and on average 12.5 statements per item. And we will see what that means in detail in a moment. And it's also a pretty impressive number because we have more than 20,000 people all over the world editing that data every month. And what that means is that Wikidata basically moved from being a tool to make our little projects a little better and to have smaller language wikis to get a kickstart and have seed data in themselves already. It became the most successful and most edited project in our movement. We just recently surpassed the English Wikipedia with regards to the number of total edits, and believe me, that's a thing. And I personally really like to look at Wikidata as the future of our movement. And the next big thing that's to come after the Wikipedia. But the thing now is, what does that mean for the scientific community and for you? And where do you fit into that picture? And for that, I suggest we take a closer look at actual things inside Wikidata. And it is, first and foremost, it's a database. The database of structured and linked open data. And its core are items. And the items describe concepts about the world. And every item has a little Q number. And while I was preparing for the talk, I found that there's actually a collaboration report item from last year. And you see it has the Q number up there. I'm not going to read that, it's a long number. The other things you notice at the very top is what we call the term box. It contains the most essential information about an item. And that is important, it contains also the translations, if all goes well, into many different languages. And that's whenever our community puts in the effort to translate things. And we will later on see an item where you could clearly see the effect of that. And what you also see there is the fundamental difference to the Wikipedia projects, because we have more than 300 Wikipedia language versions, and each of them has their own articles for the same topic, and there might be very different contents in each of them. In Wikidata, on the other side, we combine all the different languages into one item. And that has the great effect that it focuses the people editing the data, because there's just one place, and if more people go to one place and to edit, of course, it becomes a better data item because you have it then in. Maybe go to the next slide. A little later. The more people edit it, the better the quality becomes. Usually, the part we're going to look at next are the statements. So up was the term box for the item, and the item can be described by statements. And And in this example, the collaborations report was classified as an instance of. As an instance of a scholarly article. And here, in the example of Heinrich Heine, it's a coincidence that we have the same name. You can see how extensive an item can become. And you also notice how it becomes interconnected with other databases, because what you see on the right, there are all the links to all different Wikipedia articles that are there. And that goes a little bit back to the initial idea of how can we make sure that the same information in various languages is better connected. But you also see, for example, the connection to the image files. This is a file that's stored in our comments database, and it's included into the article. And what you also notice is maybe a bit of a strange thing, and that is that for some statements, the entry actually contains multiple values. In that case, for the date of birth of Heinrich Heine, apparently, the world is not so sure about what his actual date of birth was. Now, if you're a bit familiar with the Wikipedia communities, if you try to imagine how that would go in a Wikipedia article, then you know they will discuss and debate and advocate until the true birth date will prevail. But the thing is, the world is messy, and for some things, there is not one correct answer, and there might very well be a reliable source for more than one truth. But what Wikidata will do is it will give you the choice. It will give you all the possible variations for one statement. But it just not does do. It doesn't do just that. Because. A statement only gets actually weight if you can put a reference to it, if you can tell what's the source, where is it coming from. And that then, on the other hand, allows other people to make their choice what to use, which data item to use. And the thing with Wikidata is that, as I mentioned before, it can be edited by human beings. And that could be me or you or someone else just going in there, clicking on the edit button, and writing another date of birth from behind, for example. And then in Wikidata, and that's also a big difference to Wikipedia, there are bots. Wikidata is from its inception, a project that does not only look at human beings. It's architecture and the concepts within it, they are from the very beginning built on one hand to enable machines to understand the complexity of the world, and by that resulting in Google, Alexa, Siri, and others to provide meaningful answers to you and your questions in a way that the Wikipedia article would fail to do. And it also enables machines to help create and expand our knowledge. And by that, in the essence, expand all of our knowledge base, our information base that we can tap into. And that might sound, for some of us, for me definitely, at least, very exciting, collecting information, connecting it. But there is the other point with how can we use it? And currently, as for that, this, the Wikidata query service. The query builder allows you to put questions to the data, basically. And you don't even have to be a native Sparkle speaker, which is the language you would want to use if you put questions to the data. But it definitely helps to make the most out of it. With a helper, you can create queries without actually typing the text in. But of course, the more advanced questions are better answered by actually knowing Spark a little bit better. So with the basic structure of items, properties, and values, question that to us would seem super simple and trivial to answer, but to a machine and to a computer are extremely difficult, suddenly become answerable. And in order to give people a way to ask Wikidata questions, we have created the servers, and I'm going to show you a couple of examples of what potential answers could look like. Here, you see a map that shows the location of trees that have been grown out of seeds that have traveled around the moon. Or this one that gives you a timeline of Japanese comic artists. And so the examples I'm going to give you are showing you different representations of the data inside the database. And as you can see also in this example, it's not just a timeline, it's also the connection between the pictures and the data we have in Wikidata. The next one returns pictures of natural arts around the world. If you ever wondered where to go to see a natural art. And in case you have ever wondered which families had the same occupation for five generations or more, we also have the answer to that. Average duration of movies by genre and year. And last but not least, this one, I really like this one, about the distribution of death causes among members of noble families. Right? So, I guarantee you there are many more really interesting trivia knowledge to get out of the database. There are lots of examples, so if you need more, let me know. So now that we took a good look at what Wikidata is and what it does, I'd like to get a little deeper into the question, what does it have to do with science and research? And what we've seen is that Wikidata is able to give answers to interesting questions, but what else is there? And as described in the beginning of my talk, Wikidata was created to help Wikipedia to maintain their data and to talk some languages and to automate parts of the information generation. But during the last 1.5 years, it became more and more apparent that Wikibase, which is the software underneath Wikidata, is a tool that allows many different kinds of organizations to maintain, enhance, link, and work with their own data. And for many, this becomes especially powerful when it comes to metadata. I think that was already a topic a couple of times today. So what you see here is a view into the future, I would call it. And when we look at that future, we look at many different instances of Wikibases that are connected with each other and that federate their data, that reuse data from Wikidata among each other, that share their data models, and that in essence enable interdisciplinary research. As mentioned, that's a little bit in the future still, where we are today. I'm going to show you two very different examples of two pretty interesting projects. And where we are today is nicely illustrated actually by this project from the world of Welsh literature. There are currently nearly 40,000 Wikidata items about items and people associated with the collections of the National Library of Wales. And a couple of years ago, they began working and on sharing and compiling data about the book trade in Wales. And they shared data for the historic newspaper archive and journals collections and began combining these with data from third-party sources, such as the British Book Trade Index, for example. And what you see here are the publishers over time grouped by authors. And the gives them a pretty, you can start to see the research value that comes out of combining big different kinds of data sets and connecting and linking them. At Wikimedia Deutschland, we started last year to work closely with national libraries. So we work particularly with the German National Library, the French, the Netherlands, and Canada, for example. And all of them, they plan to use Wikibase as a tool to manage their metadata, to connect their metadata with Wikidata itself, but also with other instances containing bibliographic metadata, for example. And if this is the now, the Welsh the book data, imagine what that would mean on a scale of national libraries all of a sudden coming together and connecting their metadata. The research value and the possibilities for all of us in the end to find information and answers to open questions. Because, I mean, this is what we are about, right? We're about opening data, freeing data, and making it accessible back again. This is exactly in this thinking of breaking off the silos and make things come together, basically. The second project I want to look at is GWiki. So that's a little peek into GWiki. And that project combines their own data with also Wikidata and other linked data sets in order to create seed articles for every notable human gene, basically. And it works that way. Once a seed article, and that's an automated process, is created, what happens then is that seedling basically will be annotated and expanded by authors. And those authors might range from the lay audience to students to professors to academics. And with that, I finally want to get to the point of which point does interoperability get into the picture? I, of course, am happy to take questions around all the Wikidata and Wikibase things later on. It's just obviously not enough to touch on everything. And the things I just said before about the GWiki community, you start to get a notion about the fact that interoperability in my world means more than just technical standards and data flow. And while I was preparing for today, Mark Zuckerberg, thankfully, published his essay about the future priorities of Facebook, and that essay included a paragraph on interoperability. And if I should try to summarize what Mark was trying to say there, was that interoperability in his world was essentially the ability to communicate with people that are important to you regardless of which platform you are, be it Facebook, WhatsApp, or Instagram, basically. And with that, I want to go back to my earlier slide depicting the structure of the Wikibase ecosystem, because what you see here is how we envision to evolve it over the next 3 years. And I want to use it to talk about our understanding of the multiple levels of interoperability, which are essential to our vision of the Wikibase ecosystem. As described in the example of the GWiki, what will happen is it will connect very different kinds of people with each other. They speak different languages, English, Portuguese, Arabic, anyone you can think of. They come from different contexts. They come from academia. They come from non-academia. They bring their own cultures and norms. Specialized communities are forming. That's already happening today, like the librarians or biomedical researchers. And those specialized communities, they all of a sudden are confronted with volunteer communities, which are, for example, building bots to keep data in good shape. And in order to make this truly work, we will have to develop mechanisms, structures, and framework to facilitate that meeting of very different worlds. And that's what I would call the social level of interoperability. But this ecosystem will also open the door to cross-disciplinary research, which helps people like you to solve complex problems and leads to innovation by providing new angles of looking at old problems. Instead of independent researchers designing and conducting their own separate experiments within borders of their disciplines, they will be able to connect across disciplines, combining, as mentioned before, for example, chemical with biological or health-related research. They will be able to achieve groundbreaking discoveries if they find a way to create standards around data models and ontologies, that is. This is what I would call the data level of interoperability. And this cross-domain interoperability is one of the key elements for a multidisciplinary collaboration. Although high-quality disciplinary data infrastructures, so the ones that just evolve around one topic, are essential for the advancement of any discipline, the ability to use that data for cross-disciplinary research, that's what enables you specifically to address multidimensional and complex research questions, which then in turn, again, facilitates innovation, which is back to your talk beforehand. So, this piece of the whole bigger picture gets into the topic of knowledge graphs, and precisely multidisciplinary scientific knowledge graphs, because they are also a key building block for machine processable knowledge, which is what the essence of the wiki-based ecosystem is. It enhances the ability of machines to automatically find access, and that's back to your FAIR things before, interoperate and reuse data towards the goal of having machine actionable data. And that then again enables big data analysis, large scale machine learning and AI. And I know this is a lot of buzzwords right now, but the truth is that semantic web and linked data technologies are core technologies for what you do, for research. And multidisciplinary scientific knowledge graphs will similarly create and added value for the scientific community. It will be interoperable with existing knowledge graphs. That's also important. And that was now a lot about research and science, but this ecosystem, what it tries to do is enable that, but maybe even more importantly, bridge the gap back to practice. Because science for science sake might be nice and funny for a while, but it should have actual impact on people. And research data indeed already today can be used to produce actionable knowledge, such as, for example, in agriculture, using data from sea or soil or weather monitoring is already today helping farmers to understand how the phenomena affect their business. But if we want to go beyond that, we have to find a way to provide that information in an easy way. It's easy access to that kind of data, that's one thing. But it also needs to be in a format that makes sense to the audience, which it tries to address. It has to fit their context, it has to speak their language, and that in turn requires us to provide powerful infrastructure. That is what this is about. Because for Wikidata and Wikibase, we consider us as the people building the infrastructure. We're not building the apps in the end, we're not building the software in the end, we're not building the voice assistants. It's just like, A, we're not the expert, we're not the expert for those contexts, but B, we unfortunately can't do it all. But that's a crucial part, and the piece we can put in for that is to provide standardized APIs, to provide data formats that make it easier and appealing to create applications on top of it. And that piece for me is the technological level of interoperability, and it's also required the same in the other two. And to sum this all up, this is what we're aiming for to build with Wikidata and Wikibase ecosystem. It should become the essential infrastructure for free knowledge. It should be a connector, right? It's not like we do not plan to do it all. We already today have a lot of identifiers, for example, in our data sets that connect back to other databases, because we don't need the data to be all in one place. It will enable research to transcend disciplinary silos, and we will make data and research results available to as many people out there as possible by creating a platform agnostic infrastructure, and that then again allows people to tap into the sum of our knowledge and make it accessible and meaningful in their context. And with that, I'm done. Thank you so much for having me.
So we are running a little bit. This was much muted, sorry.
Wait,
well done.
I'm sorry.
No.
Could you?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. You did a great job. we are a little behind time, so I'll just need you to switch to this one. Yeah, you can take it off. So, please find Francisco over lunch. We want to take a group photo.